Okay, this is Neal Morse, and we are musicians having coffee and talking about stuff. And my wonderful guest today is Bill Hubauer, or otherwise known to his friends as Hubie. And glad to have you on, Bill.
Thanks, Neal. Yeah. Big fan of the podcast.
Oh, that's great.
And although I feel like the coffee part of it doesn't always get enough attention, so I want to just really focus on this right now.
Oh wow!
You got the press going.
Yeah.
Ooh. Oh, that's so satisfying. Oh, so good. We're gonna pour that in here.
Man, you're making me jealous. I want to do that. Hey, that looks really good, man.
So cheers.
Yeah, cheers. Mine's gotten a little bit cold, but yeah, it's all right.
Do you consider yourself a coffee guy? And I mean, I know you drink a lot of coffee, but like, are you snobby about it or
no?
Pretty
not
much drink whatever.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. If somebody can be happy getting a coffee from Dunkin' Donuts, which I can be, yeah. I think then you're not really a coffee connoisseur. No, you know,
yeah.
Yeah, I like it. And, you know, like everybody else in the whole world, my relationship to coffee has been transformed. I was trying to tell, who was I? I was with one of my grandkids, I think. And we were having coffee like at a regular restaurant. And it was just, you know, like the watery stuff in the white cup thing. It's like,
right. Yeah,
I just want
yeah.
you guys to know, this is what coffee was in America until like 1996 or something.
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
Cause they're just like, oh man, that's terrible. Like you put like one little thimble of cream and it turns white. That's how weak it is. Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. So I didn't really drink coffee till I was like 40.
Yeah. I didn't drink it till I was, I think in my early 30s, but, and this is the question. I mean, I drink it black and, objectively, I mean, there's nobody in the world that's ever going to drink black coffee and think, oh yeah, give me some more of that for the first time, right?
Right.
I mean, it's objectively terrible.
Right.
I don't care. Now, until you train your palate, to kind of focus
funny?
In on. But the question is why do we do it? How do you ever get to like coffee? Because like, oh, this is terrible. Give me another drink. You know?
Yeah.
Let me try it again. Oh, it's still bad. Like,
yeah.
How many times do you have to taste it before you start to like it? And why do we put ourselves through that?
Yeah. There were some moments, I think in my podcast with my brother, Al, that was, oh yeah, it's a terrible show. Yeah. I watched it 3 times or so, you know, it's like,
yeah,
it was terrible.
Right.
Yeah. There's a lot of stuff in life like that. Like, I don't know, the first time you, especially alcohol. I mean, I remember when I was a kid tasting a beer for the first time, just going like, wow, that's terrible. And then you can train your palate you're a beer drinker. I know. Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah. I mean, you're like quite a connoisseur, aren't you? Oh, there you go.
I'm a beer guy. I'm a craft beer guy.
Yeah. Craft
and it's
beer.
The same thing. It's the same thing. Like before the mid-90s, all the beer you could get would be, it's just terrible. And
right.
Again, why do we learn to like these things when we don't like them to start, you know?
Yeah. I guess in the case of coffee and beer, it might be for the physical effects actually. No,
I mean, I'm sure for many, many people, maybe that's the majority of the reasons, but I don't really react to caffeine. And, you know, I don't really remember a time when I was, I'm all about the flavor on beer. I don't, you know, I would prefer that, like if I could get non-alcoholic beer that tasted good, I would just drink that.
Right. Yeah. Oh, sure.
But, yeah.
But anyway, I read a comment about the podcast that said something like, you know, something saying what a terrible interviewer I am. And maybe that's because I don't think about this as being like interviewing.
Right.
I mean,
yeah, I hope not.
It's right.
Yeah, no.
I mean, it's supposed to be just like, just guys talking about stuff, basically.
Yeah. Well, I'm very much, I enjoy stream of consciousness conversations.
Mm.
Like just one thought connects to the next, connects to the next. And we don't have to, you know, we'll just talk about whatever. So coffee was the first thing on my mind. And there, so, I mean, I appreciate that. I've enjoyed the conversational nature of the podcast, of your style of doing it. So, you know.
Well, cool. Well, you know, but, there's always, there's always some people that, you know, there's always, everybody's a critic, right? But, no, I mean, I didn't really take it to heart. I just thought, oh, well, that's because I'm not thinking of it like that, really, you know. But, yeah. And I'm not going to start thinking, if I start thinking about it like that, then I'll just quit doing it, you know? Right. Yeah. I only wanted to do it because it sounded like something that was fun.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, you know, I don't know. I mean, I like to read a few, like, you know, when we obviously just released, you know, our new single and video, and you read a few feedback, and you know where you're going to get all positive feedback, and you know where you're not going to get that. And but I'm always interested in just what they're taking away from the song, like how is it impacting them, you know, what do they like about it or not like about it. But you know, like if I were to again read it and believe all the critics, you know, my keyboard sounds on the new single ruined the song. So I apologize for that.
Okay. Speaking of ruining songs, we got to tell this thing that's become like, it's become a staple in the Neal Morse Band, phrases and lingo.
Yeah.
You want to tell the story?
Sure. I'll tell the story. Okay. So, let me just lead into it. So, everybody, who follows Mike on social media knows that he likes to make these collages of all the album covers and different things. And he makes, he recently updated his collage of all of his discography, all the discs that he, you know, that he's been a part of. And I looked through them and I counted them up, and I'm on 14 of those, counting all the live albums and Morse Fests. And
wow,
all that.
That's crazy.
And, yeah. And to me, it's crazy because the first time I heard Mike play was I heard Pull Me Under, Dream Theater, on the radio back in 92 or 3, whenever it was. And I thought to myself, this is kind of a cool song, but it's like this drummer is doing everything he can to ruin it.
Man, you're going to get in trouble.
Yeah. Right. I never heard like that style of that sort of bombastic playing was not something that I was used to hearing. And so to me, it just sounded like, what in the world is he doing? So my first thought upon hearing him was that, and yet now here we are all these years later and I'm on, you know, 14, you know, released recordings with him and he's one of my favorite drummers.
Yeah.
And I love playing with him and he's
so amazing.
You know, but
how
so
did it come
funny.
Out? When did you have the guts to tell him that?
I told him on our first tour in
Europe, right?
With the Flower Kings. Yeah.
Hey, I got to tell you, man, the first time I heard you play, I said, man, that drummer's doing everything he can to ruin the song. So now it's like, this is something that we say in the band, like on a very regular basis. It's like, you know, hey, Eric, it sounds like you're doing everything you can to ruin this song. You know, it's just like about everything. We'll be watching TV together and like, oh, that guy's doing everything he can to ruin this TV show.
Yeah. But so that's funny. And you know, and I love Mike and I'm so, you know, thankful to be playing with him. And I just think it's funny that it started out that way.
Yeah. Well, a lot of things start off really funny compared to what they turn into.
Yeah.
You know, like how Randy, when he first, you know, he first sent me some of his demos or something, you know, he was really trying to get a hold of me and wanted me to play on his album. And, you know, the way I thought of him then, you know, compared to what I think of him now, I mean, it just goes to show you that you, you don't know all of what people are or what they're capable of.
Right.
Or, you know, you'll judge something like really early on, and yeah. it turns out the dude's a monster, you know. And not that I just thought, I don't know, I don't want to say what I thought, but well, and didn't I completely reject you?
Well, it wasn't like I called. So I, you were selling, I had a CD on Radiant. I had called you and asked you, I was in a Christian prog rock band back in the 90s called 10.10. And we had a Christmas album and you sold it on Radiant. So I had your number from that. And after one came out, I was inspired to call you out of the blue and say, hey, I don't know what you're doing, but you know, if you need a keyboard player for your next tour, I'm your guy. And turns out that you didn't tour that album. So there was nothing going on at that point, but it was, you know, there was that awkward, like, wow, you know, so, wow, you think you're being called to do this kind of thing? Or, you know, we had that kind of conversation kind of,
oh, did we?
More of a spiritual, you know, you were trying to see, you know, where my heart was. Was I just a fanboy calling or was I being led by the spirit to do it?
At that point, you know, I had felt like the Lord wanted me to stay home with the kids. The kids were, you know, that real developmental time.
Sure.
You know, and I don't remember what ages they would have been, maybe 5 and 7 or something like that. And I just, so I didn't go out for a while. It wasn't until a little bit later, I decided, to heck with the kids. They can be corrupted. You know, no, I took them with, you know, yeah. Will was getting up and singing Cradle of the Grave. And, you know, we started doing the ministry in Europe probably around that same time around. I think the first time that we went over there to do some of the church things was right after One came out. Cause I remember playing a lot of stuff from One, but I didn't tour with a band until Colin had said, hey man, if you want to do some shows, I could put together a band and we can learn everything and you can just walk in and do it. I was like, oh
yeah,
really?
Yeah.
That sounds pretty good.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
You know, he said he would like, I think he even got involved like booking the shows and, you know, he kind of like spoon fed me back into it. And that a lot of those felt really, really supercharged in the spirit. So I was like, oh, I guess God can show up at a rock concert.
Yeah.
I'm kidding. Cause I knew that from way earlier.
Sure, sure.
That's a joke, but yeah, I don't know. You know, you go through different seasons in your life where you're just kind of feeling different things. And at that time I wasn't, wasn't really feeling to play, but
right. Well, the reality is I couldn't have toured then. I don't know why I even called you. I just there was no way I could have really have done it with my circumstances. And so the funny thing is that then fast forward however many years later, I started working from home with a flexible schedule that I could tour, and it's right then is when you were looking to put together a new band. And it's kind of a miracle that I even found out about it in time because, and this is a fun story that the it was being talked about on, I was on some, progressive rock email list or something.
Yeah. Back when chat room days or something, right?
Yeah. And, I had them all like routed into a folder automatically. And like, you know, I have mail filters that send all these emails to this folder. And I just quit reading it. I hadn't read it for any of those for 2 years.
Mm.
And I was going to click on something and I missed, and I clicked on that folder and it popped like for the first time in 2 years, and it popped up. And the very top message was, you know, open auditions for new Morse band. And I was like, what?
Wow.
Because that email could have been like a year and a half old for all I knew.
Hand of God, you know? Dude.
So I looked at it. I was like, oh, I still have time. And so you know, all those things. Yeah, and I do believe that it's too, everything just lined up too perfectly, you know, for it to be just happenstance.
Oh yeah, well I'm certain of all that. And are your audition tapes out there somewhere?
Yeah, they're on YouTube.
They're on YouTube. Everybody should look them up. Look them up. What, yeah. Bill Hubauer auditions for the Neal Morse Band? Would that?
Yeah, yeah.
Those were great, and, man.
Yeah, thanks. And you know, they're coming up on 10 years old.
Oh my goodness!
Can you believe that?
That's crazy. Wow. Yeah, and didn't you play like the Star Trek theme on saxophone or something?
I was like trying to play. I was just trying to do a bunch of weird stuff because I just wanted to be noticed because I didn't know.
Yeah.
I didn't know how many submissions you were getting. And I thought, well, I just want you to like notice mine. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, and so I played some sax and I just was like, I knew, you know, you were a Star Trek guy. So I thought, oh, you know, I played like the Star Trek theme on sax and just goofy stuff like that.
Yeah. Well, and you, everybody that actually wound up, I mean, I didn't plan it this way, but, the people that we wound up using, that I wound up using, all did above and beyond what was asked for in the requested email. I like to tell young people that, you know, if you're going after a gig, do more than what they're asking for. Give them all you got.
Right.
Because Eric sent in tapes auditioning on keyboards and guitar and singing. You auditioned on, you know, it was only requested for one instrument, and you sent like five, right? You sent examples of sax and strings. And by the way, I still want to incorporate more of your multi-instrumental stuff.
Yeah, the problem, I appreciate that, and I want to do it too. My reality is, and like, I'm sitting here. I got my violin out for the first time in like 5 years, and I've been working on it, and I'm really pretty bad. And I wasn't that good to begin with. And I haven't, after having not played for so long, it's like, man, I'm terrible. So I'm working on it again. So if I can get it better, then we'll.
Well, and it's one thing to do, like, you know, to work on a piece and just do a short little audition tape or to play something in the studio. Like, you know, I play mandolin on stuff in the studio, but I have to like tune everything and to just like work out some little thing. Yeah. But if I was going to like take a mandolin solo live, it would be really very funny.
Right.
You know,
I gotcha. Yeah. Yeah. The same way you can do things. You know, I'm obviously very proficient on keyboard, but other than not being like a shredder kind of player or anything, I'm actually a pretty decent guitar player as well. But anything else I play just good enough to do a specific thing that I'm trying to do.
Right.
Okay. I want to play this one line or something. Mm-hmm. Okay. I can work on it. And then I can do it.
Yeah.
You know, capture that moment. So yeah.
I know a guy who used to own a music store, and he would just pick up different instruments in the store and go like, oh, and do some riff and like, wow. He said, yeah, I've learned like a 5-second riff on every instrument in this store, but that's all I know. Like, I pick up a saxophone and go like, or something. And like, oh, wow. So that's not
people,
quite what you
that.
Are, but I'm not accusing
what
you.
What I've said... I've done stuff like that. I got to play something that seemed really fancy. And then I basically said, you've heard it. You've just heard everything I can do on this instrument.
Right.
You know?
Right. Yeah. But your voice was such a powerful selling point for me too. I was, you know, I was looking for a band that could do, you know, all these different things, you know, all the vocal, the five-part vocal things and all of that. Yeah. And, you know, my range is, you know, limited. And so I was looking for people that could hit the high notes. And so, okay. And we always tease Bill about
the chin
vibrato. He does the chin vibrato. Can you give us some chin vibrato?
No. Just watch. Just, Just watch any of our live videos and you'll see it. Hey, there's some famous, but I can't quote say who they are now because I can't remember, but I've seen some famous singers do that. So.
Oh, I have too.
I felt like,
there's nothing wrong with it. It's just, there's something funny about it. I don't know.
Well, the only reason I can do the vibrato without it, but that's how I learned. When I was first learning to do it, I was struggling to like figure out how to do it. And so I found if I kind of connected the internal to something external, physical, that I can mentally think about what I'm doing.
Right.
Then I learned to do the vibrato. And if I really concentrate, I don't have to do that anymore. But
right,
I still do.
it's something that we're letting you in on all the all the private NMB joking things. We're always like, Bill, come on, do your thing. Especially, man, you get really up there.
And I can't, and that was new with the band. I never sang that high before, and it was on the Grand Experiment tour. I started to, because you're singing a lot. That was the most I'd ever sang, like every night was singing. And I just stumbled over a different, I have no training. I don't know what I'm doing. But I found a way to sort of open up more to hit higher notes. Mm-hmm. And that really was a revelation. So.
Oh, yeah. Well, it was kind of a revelation to me, those first tours as a band, by the way, I remember, because Randy had been talking about us getting together to write as a band I don't know how long, but for many months before he was kind of nudging me, and I kept saying, yeah, I'll pray about it. Well, when I did pray about it, I mean, I remember feeling distinctly like, yes, it was a real yes inside. So I feel like the whole Neal Morse Band thing is definitely a God thing. But what isn't, right?
Yeah, right. Well, I remember when you told me we were in Germany. I can picture the club, but I don't remember which one it was. To tell you the name, and we were.
Did it have a lot of female body parts on the wall, Bill?
Well, I'm picturing the green room. It was the green room was upstairs with all these windows that opened out. And we could look out on the street and see all the people out there and stuff.
Sounds like Markthalle. Is that Hamburg Markthalle where you're above the train tracks?
No, not that one. Okay. That was a different one. But when you told me, you said, hey, I've been thinking about doing, writing as a group. And on one hand, I'm trying to affirm you. I want to affirm you. That'd be great. But honestly, I just assumed that was going to happen. It never occurred to me that we wouldn't start writing as a group at some point.
Oh, really?
It was like you told me that. I was like, well, yeah, of course. Of course we're going to do that. I didn't realize how big of a deal that was for you, because there was a lot of – because your solo prog stuff was really – you were in Flying Colors in Transatlantic, and – you were giving up control of your only prog output.
Right. That's right.
By doing that. And I did not appreciate how big of a deal that was for you. Now, it turns out you've discovered you can still do solo prog stuff,
Yeah.
With Solo Gratia.
Yeah.
But at the time it was just sort of like, well, this is my only outlet of that. I'm sure you were thinking And I know that when I say give up control, it wasn't like a vanity issue, like this is my thing and do it my way. I know your heart. I know that it was really more about if you feel strongly about a certain thing that God puts on you to do something a certain way, you can do it the way that you're feeling it exactly. And you don't have to, there's no compromising. not that the end result would be bad or, you know, worse. It just would be different from what was on your heart.
Right.
So I appreciate that. That's sometimes you need to just, I just need to do what it's on my heart.
Yeah. Well, the main thing for me, why I pray about everything, is I just feel like it's really simple. I just feel like God knows way better than I do. You know, he knows whether it's going to be, it's going to go well. You know, he knows like if he's going to be in it helping us creating, you know, then I, so that's why, you know, I try to remember, sometimes I forget, but I try to remember to pray about every decision. Because God's way smarter than I am. Right. But back to the vocal thing, you know, when we went out, you know, there was a lot of tours where I was really struggling vocally. I think everybody, all the fans know that, you know, where, you know, I can't hit the notes at the end, or sometimes just even like at the beginning, you know, I was just like, man, just even getting my voice warmed up. You know, it's a lot of work to sing, you know, these like, you know, 3-hour concerts, you know, being one of the main singers. It was pretty demanding stuff, you know, doing the Neal Morse tours. And so I was amazed at how well all of our voices, it just seemed like such a great thing to divide it up.
Yeah.
And
it was just enough. It was just enough relief for everybody, you know, especially for you. That little bit of other people singing was just enough, and you could get through the whole tour and not have any problems.
Yeah. Yeah. It was amazing. And I wasn't, you know, I would give you guys a lot of the high notes, so I wasn't straining as much either.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
I would give you our, that the way it was, we wrote it together in such a way you know, so what a blessing. I remember one time didn't we just do 6 in a row or something? And we got offered a 7th, I think. It was something like that. Like, well, we could play in Luxembourg, but it'll be 7 in a row. And I was like, guys, well, what do you think? You want to do it? It was something like that. And we said, yeah, I think we can do it. And I remember just being amazed at how good our voices were on the 7th night. You know, wow. Yeah. And I just think it's all part of, you know, God working everything for good, you know, just knowing what's a better plan. And, but it always does involve that, like, divesting of self thing, you know, it doesn't, and the more we're willing to do that.
And being, you know, being vulnerable, like I remember on our first, on the Green Experiment tour, there was talk of, should we use samples, some additional vocal samples to help out? And I actually went through and prepared a bunch and tried to figure out how we could do them and keep them synchronized and whatever. And then when we just got to rehearsal, we just never did it. And I think the only thing I did it on the song Grand Experiment, which we have that weird, I can't remember, there's this weird vocal echoey thing that we did, but I did.
Oh, right. Yeah.
There.
Yeah. Yeah.
But we just never really did it. And, I'm so grateful that we started out just sort of going for it and opening ourselves up for, well, maybe this won't work, but we're going to try it.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, it's always better when you're really performing the thing. Is, you know, as little samples and stuff as we can get away with, it's always, it just feels better. I think it's better for the audience.
Cause
even if it's a little, it's always going to be a little more rough.
Yeah.
You know, but
there's less to go wrong too. You know, it's like,
right.
You know, there's been a couple times, we have used like percussion backing tracks, like we used, what's the slow song from Sola? Well, the end of the end of the conflict has like that Latin kind of slow. It's like some Latin percussion, home, already home or something.
Already
like
home.
That.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Yeah. And so we have this percussion thing. So, you know, and I am sending Mike a click to his ears and that, we just was such a rare thing for us to do that. And it was like every night is like, you know, I was always so nervous every night that it was going to sync up or it was going to work right, you know? So it's just much better if you don't have to do that stuff.
Yeah. Yeah. But sometimes you have to do it. There's just no way around it.
Yeah.
But we keep it to a minimum. And thankfully everybody's just good enough to pull the stuff off. I mean, that's what you need. You need to actually be able to actually do it, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I'm just so thrilled to be playing with a bunch of guys that can do, that can make that happen. I watched, I don't know. I guess I shouldn't, you know, I'm surprised sometimes, like when I'll see even like fan footage of something, I'll think, wow, that actually sounds really good. Like somehow that was okay.
We're very impressed with ourselves, aren't we?
Yeah, I know. Well, I'm not assuming that it does. Like, I don't like I just, you know, you just do what you can do. And then I guess when we play live, you're not always hearing the whole world. You know, you're hearing mostly yourself and just enough other stuff to stay together.
Yeah.
And a lot of times you miss out on cool stuff that somebody else is doing.
Oh, yeah.
And then when you see it back live, and it's like, wow, that was really great.
That's why you need to go back to Wedges, man. Be in the room. I'm the only one who doesn't wear in-ears. And it's a bummer for me. Like, I'll want to go over, like the old days, like in the clubs, you know? You'd go over to the guitar player.
Talk to somebody, and
make some joke about something, you know, whatever. Yeah. Like, check out the other guy. Look at him. Oh, you know, or whatever. Mm-hmm. And no one can ever hear anything because everybody's like, what? You know, too late. Oh, I like to be in the room and you know, hear as much as I can of everybody. But it is delicate because you do need to have your stuff louder, in which case sometimes if you want to hear everybody and be louder, you're talking about a lot of volume to get above the drums.
Yeah. Yeah, I know. I mean, I prefer to have the Wedges and be in the room, except that my ears are just ringing every night.
Yeah, sure.
And I don't like to wear earplugs. So
yeah, I don't like to wear earplugs either. Yeah, I know. So I'll be deaf long before you probably, but at least I was in the room, man. I probably won't care about that when I'm going, right?
Right. Yeah, really.
Yeah.
I wanted to show you this.
Huh?
I got this for Christmas.
Oh, yeah. Is there some
Bob Ross
positive energy drink? Yeah, there you go.
I haven't opened it. I don't want to.
Oh, that's great. Is there some kind of Bob Ross resurgence happening or something?
I don't know. Always.
It seems like there's like a lot of young people are like into Bob Ross right now.
Yeah. I wanted to have my Bob Ross mug.
Yeah.
That had his, and when it would get hot with the coffee, it would change.
Yeah.
It would do something. I can't remember, but it broke. So.
Yeah. My first real experience. I mean, I think my son Will used to watch Bob Ross when he was little, but I never really tuned it in. It wasn't until, Bill started putting it on in the tour bus after the shows. So we do these shows and meet and greets and, you know, all that stuff, and then finally get out to the tour bus, and Bill would make himself a bowl of what's that cereal you?
Oh, blueberry frosted mini wheats.
Right. And he's like, "Hey, man, let's put on some Bob." Right, total chill.
Yeah, you gotta wind down. You can't just go. Like, I can't sleep in on the road because I have to work. So that's a whole other story. But I have to get up and work on the tour bus. And so I have to kind of wind myself down quickly after the show so I can get to sleep.
Yeah.
And that to me, you put on some Bob Ross and just have a little bit of comfort food, a little bit of cereal or something and just chill.
Yeah. It's great. Well, I wound up getting really into it too, man.
Yeah.
I was like, yeah, man, you know, Like we were somewhere, I think maybe we were in Europe, and we couldn't get Bob. We were like, oh, wow.
We didn't have internet or on the bus. Couldn't stream it.
Wow. We need some Bob, man.
But that voice, just so soothing. It just calms you down. And
yeah. Yeah, you know. It's great. It's great stuff. So you were tell me about the apologetics and stuff. How'd that come about?
I mostly have just played in local bands around Western Pennsylvania. I live just north of Pittsburgh, and I kind of quit playing for a while, just was frustrated. And then a buddy of mine asked me to start playing at a worship service at a church. And that sort of rejuvenated me. I sort of had a purpose and started hanging out with a lot of other Christian musicians. And there was this guy, I had a band that was kind of a prog rock, Christian prog rock band, and we had done some shows with this group called Apologetics. That's a Christian parody band. So their tagline used to be, maybe it still is, Weird Al meets Billy Graham. That was sort of their thing. They would do, Bible stories. They would change the lyrics to popular songs to Bible stories. And a lot of them would be very witty and would include, and would point. So it was amusing, but they would point you to the scripture. Almost every song had the scripture reference right in the lyric, and you can go. And it really was a ministry that I could see a lot of fruit in. I saw a lot of people really getting into reading the Bible after being amused by the song, and it referenced the scripture, so they would go read that. And
what was a good example of that?
So they would do Hotel California was changed to a story about Mary and Joseph, no room at the inn, those hotel can't afford ya.
Right.
And there was a pop song back in the early in the 2000s, story of a girl. I can't remember not who did it, but there was a story of a squirrel, and it was about Noah's Ark, the squirrel that made it onto Noah's Ark.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow, that's really clever. Did you write any of that stuff?
No, I just played. So I just played in the band, and then eventually helped record, was sort of like the producer for a while. And I haven't really been involved other than I still master every few months. I'll master a CD for them.
That's cool. So they're still doing it
for quite a while.
They're still at it. Wow.
Yeah. Yeah. Not, they don't really gig anymore that I'm aware of. I think they just put out the CDs. Yeah. But so I mentioned working on the tour bus. So I'm the only guy in our band who isn't a full-time musician. I work for, I know you know this, but for everybody else, I work for Adobe as a software engineer.
Right.
And I was always the musician who liked his day job. And I found it just as satisfying, the creation aspect of software, creating software, just as satisfying as creating music. I always wanted to do both. Since high school, I always wanted to do both, and I'm still able to do both.
Really? And, you started working on computers and stuff in high school?
Yeah.
Were you in high school in the 50s?
No, it was in the early 80s. Remember the Radio Shack TRS-80s?
Yeah.
That's what I had, one of those guys.
Okay.
Yep. You had to load the program off a cassette.
Right, right. Floppy disks and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah. And if you wanted, when I was first got into it, if I wanted to play a game on my computer, I had to write it first.
Wow.
So you had to write your own games.
So you got in your 10,000 hours in the computer world.
Oh, yeah, I did.
Before the 90s hit or something.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah.
Oh, so you're one of those guys.
Yeah.
Have you ever read Malcolm Gladwell's book, Outliers?
I've never read it. I am very aware of it. and I've had it recommended to me a bunch of times, but I've never read it.
There's a really interesting statistic that he brings up. Is that I think he counts like the 20 richest people of all time, like including like mm-hmm. Cleopatra and whatnot. And like six of them were born in 1954, 1955, or 1956. Like six of the richest people that ever walked the face of the earth. And his point was that they were like between 20 and 21 and 22 when Popular Mechanics had the article about the personal computer, when the first buildable personal computer came out, whatever year that was, 76 or something like that. Mm-hmm. And is that like the engineers that were a little bit older had kids and stuff, and they couldn't leave their jobs to go get in their 10,000 hours on this new thing. But the guys that were just at the right age, the Bill Gateses and all the Silicon Valley guys, I thought that was a really interesting thing. He was just talking about, like, you know, a lot of times it has your level of success is can you get started in something early enough to get your 10,000 hours in to master it before it becomes like the huge takeoff.
Right.
And if you can do that, then, and so he gives a bunch of examples of that in the book, which I just thought that was really an interesting thing.
Yeah. So I was like 10 years too late though.
Yeah. You were 10 years too late, but still a lot of guys that started in the 80s,
mm-hmm.
I have friends that started just like that. They were just really into it. They got early Macs and started messing around with it.
Yeah.
And they're like very wealthy people now.
But I took a music detour. I didn't really get back into computers full time until 88, 87, and 88 around there.
Mm-hmm.
And so for like at least 5 years, I thought, I'm going to give music a shot. And
that was your downfall.
Yeah, I know. See, I would have been so much more successful in software if I jumped right into it. And it's probably true.
It's probably true. Yeah.
Yeah. But, you know, I just think it's such a fallacy, you know, the idea that, you know, to be successful in music, you have to, you know, to make it means that you have to do it full time and it has to be like your entire identity. And it just isn't true at all. Plus it depends on what your definition of success is. But, one of the reasons I kind of got out of music for a while is I just realized that the thing that I loved about music wasn't there if I wasn't doing the exact kind of music that I like to do. So I just kind of got a lot pickier about what I would do because I just didn't enjoy certain kinds of, you know, gigs.
Right.
And it's like, I don't, you know, I can just make money on software. I don't want to have to play music I don't want to play or do, you know, whatever.
Sure. Yeah. Because if you're trying to make a living playing covers in clubs, then you're talking about the end of the 80s, beginning of 90s. So you're like, how much fun is it to play West End Girls?
Yeah, I played that.
Did you? I played it too.
I did.
You know, what was one of the ones that I used to sing? I used to sing one, a really funny one. Give me a minute. Go ahead and talk while I think about it.
I thought when I got tired of gigging, I thought I had a little home studio kind of brewing, and I thought let me try to produce some singer songwriters because I can play a bunch of stuff. So have them come in and I'll help them. And I started to try to do that. And if I just either I didn't really like the songs, or I wanted to do, I was hearing them a different way than the artist was hearing it. And it's like, well, you know, if I can't do it the way I want to do it, then I don't want to do it.
Right.
You know, but I know people, but I know I have a good friend his name's Rick Wachowski. He was a guitar player for Crack the Sky. If you remember those guys.
Oh yeah. I remember those guys.
They were really good.
Yeah.
And
great.
He's, he, he's had a studio for as long as I've known him, since the '80s, you know? And this guy, he's like, people talk about like the nicest guy. Oh, he's the nicest guy in the world. Like, he's one of those nicest guys, and he has the ability to put himself fully into your project, regardless of whether or not it's his thing or not. And like, I would look at him and see how he could manifest all this enthusiasm for something that, you know, you can't like everything, but he just seemed like he did. And, right. And I thought, well, I'm never going to be him. I'm never going to be that guy. So I'm not, this isn't really my thing to get into to producing.
Yeah. Maybe that's why I've never really gotten into producing anything that I wasn't directly involved in. Yeah. I've tried, but it just hasn't panned out, but it still might, you know, I'm open to it. It would be an interesting thing to try to do, especially at this stage of my life, you know, it'd be a cool thing, you know, but, it just hasn't turned out yet, but there are some artists that I like, and you have to really like the artist.
Yeah,
you know, I mean, I couldn't do it like a job at all. You know, I'd have to be really pretty into it. But I'm also, as an artist, I don't want to tell anybody what to do. You know, I think my producer style would be sort of like my pastoring style, which is like, well, you pray about it and do what you feel to do. You know, pretty much like, I don't know. I've never felt like, some people, it comes naturally to them to like kind of tell people what to do. It doesn't come naturally to me. I can tell people what I think. I'll tell them, well, in my opinion, but to have the producer is supposed to have the last say, to have the last say on somebody else's record.
I know.
That'd be weird.
It is, yeah. Yeah.
I mean, I always say like, well, this is what I think, but you know, you're the artist. So
if you
feel it this way, then that's what you should do.
I've told you this before, but you said something to me this past year that really, really impacted me about dealing with stuff like that. And it was, you know, you felt one way about something and Mike felt a different way about it. And there was a little back and forth, like, we should do this, we should do that.
Whatever. Never happened.
And you just basically said, well, Mike seems to want it a lot more than I do, so we'll do it his way. Like, you know, respect. I've never factored in the passion, somebody else's passion, into my debating philosophy. Like, if you really feel like, wow, this is really, really, this is important to me, but it's really, really, really important to them, and that has to count for something.
Sure.
Right? Especially with people that you respect.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's like, well, if he feels that strongly about it, okay, I'll let this one go, whatever. So that was a revelation to me. I never considered that. To me, it's always been more, you know, like, this is his idea and this is my idea, and you kind of negotiate, and you know, we used to negotiate, like, you know, I would want to do something and you were like, I don't know. And then there was something else that I want that we had another disagreement on. And I said, okay, well, I'll give you this one if I can have that other one.
Right. Yeah.
If I can put that vocal here, you can, I'll change this part over here.
You do the swap.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, like, I'll buy that. You can pay me $50 less. I'll buy that drum fill for $50. That.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
The other thing about Mike, though, is that he always feels so almost, well, no, that's not true, but very often he's very passionate.
Yeah.
You know, he's just like, come on, guys. Oh, I love the way he always says, fulfill my sonic fantasy. Let's just try it this way once. And like, oh, really? Okay. And he'll lay out this whole arrangement of the song and then we'll play it through. And a lot of times the rest of us are like, well, that's okay. He's like, guys, that was it. Come on. Like, he's so enthusiastic about it.
His
enthusiasm has carried me through a lot of things, and he turned out to be so right. later on. It's like, hey, man, thanks for, we've both thanked each other for like, hey, thank you for pushing me through that part. Thank you for standing your ground on this thing, you know, but it's a really challenging thing. And for me, again, it takes a lot of prayer to know, like, Lord, give me the wisdom to know when to stand my ground and when to give. And, you know, cause there's going to be a lot of give and take in any collaboration. And, who is sufficient for these things? Who can know? We can't always know in the moment, and we don't have a lot of moments.
Yeah.
You know, it's not like there's a ton of time, like where the Eagles sitting in the studio for 2 years or something. Right. You know what I mean? There isn't a ton of time.
You gotta make quick decisions.
You gotta make quick decisions. And then, you know, I mean, we sometimes when we have to, if we feel dissatisfied, you know, we've all flown back together. Well, we just don't feel like, you know, sometimes it was just like I didn't feel like it was done.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, and I really appreciate everybody being kind enough and willing enough to come back and work on it again. But, man, the creative process is a real challenge. And a lot of give and take. But this last album, I was just doing an interview. I did an interview today with Prog Magazine, an Eclipsed German thing.
Mm-hmm.
And, yeah, you know, it's all about the new album. And the thing that amazed me about the new album was just how easy it was. Didn't you feel like it was just easy?
Yeah, almost too easy. Because that's how we ended up with, like, that was the hard part. The hard part was that it was too easy to write all that material. And then we had just way too much. And we just hated to let any of it go, you know, or relegate it to the bonus disc.
Well, yeah, we couldn't agree. I mean, there were a couple things I thought, well, I could see that on the bonus disc. But then somebody else would go like, dude, that's my favorite song. No way. Right. Yeah. But then we only had 40 minutes. In fact, the Mike's board is right here. The board. Let's see if we can see it. Can you see it?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Do you see the whole thing or?
Yep. Yeah, pretty much. Yeah.
Yeah. So that was the thing, was like, it was really you and Mike were trying to figure out, it was after Eric and Randy left, and I was kind of checked out too, wasn't I? I was kind of like just breezing in and out, because I thought what Mike's going to do is drums, and I'll just come in and listen. But then it was like, hey, I think we want this to be a double, but we don't have enough material. What should we do?
Yeah, we were like, I don't know. We felt like, I mean, it's a little subjective about how long the discs need to be for a double. But we felt like we needed like another 15 minutes or something like that.
Yeah. Because it was like 40 and 40, and we felt like that was too short.
And we thought, and we tried it. We thought, oh, we talked about a lot of different covers things. So we were talking about like a bonus disc with a bunch of covers, and then we ended up just settling on Bridge. Actually, no, we didn't know it was going to be Bridge. We thought we'll do one cover, and then we'll resurrect the way it had to be from the Great Adventure.
That was all you and Mike. I came in one day, and it's like, okay, we got the plan. I was like, oh, really? Oh,
yeah,
okay.
Yeah. but we weren't sure what the cover idea was going to be, and then Mike wasn't in the room, and I said, "Hey, I got an idea for Bridge Over Troubled Water," and we went in there and hashed it out. But here's the funny thing: I wish this would have been filmed, because this was hysterical. So the way it had to be was originally part of a suite, so it wasn't a complete song. It didn't have a bridge,
right,
or anything. Just kind of A-B-A-B kind of a song. And
it was from The Great Adventure, wasn't it?
Yeah, yeah, right. And so I brought up my iPhone, and I had enough sense before we came in that I organized, I had like, I don't know, 30 like chord progression melodies that could be like slow, you know, kind of ballady, you know, verses or bridges or something like that.
Really?
And And Mike and I just sat through there and we just played. Okay, how about this? Was this, could this be a good bridge? And I would listen to it. Okay, and I would put it in the right key and try another one. So we just went down my list of like Legos, just piece of like, here's a bridge, you know.
Piece of the puzzle.
And we hit on the one that we ended up using, and it's like, okay, this is going to be it then. So, you know, it was funny that's the way that was put together.
Yeah. And you guys tracked that. You took out the original demos and then you sliced it. You cut in the bridge of but it was just you and Mike, right?
Yeah.
Oh, mm-hmm. At that point. And then
we
all overdubbed to what you had done. But you and I worked quite a bit on the Bridge Over Troubled Water arrangement, I think, before Mike showed up.
I knew how I wanted it to end with the big, the modulation, bass pedals come in, big harmonies.
Big slow, yeah. Sail on, and, silver girl. Yeah.
Right, exactly. And then I kind of had an idea that, like, what the verses might be like, but we need some like special sauce on this. We need some kind of thing. And so then you and I started working on it. And I think it's fair to say that, you know, that we were inspired by Yes's take on America, Simon Carbuncle.
Yeah,
America.
Sure.
And it was like,
it's pretty obvious.
Yeah. And so, you know, we kind of, that was sort of the philosophy behind the way that was approached. And then we just sort of bashed it. And it really was like, we had like almost no time. And it was like, okay, we just kind of bashed it out. And I hope that's going to work.
Yeah.
I really wasn't sure it was going to work until all the parts were in there.
I know. Me too. I think we did the first part before Mike came, you know, and then, cause he doesn't get around till around 1 o'clock or something like that. So I think we worked on a click with a down, da, da, down, down, down. And then it was just like organ fill, like real space, like just like placeholder stuff. And I was totally thinking when it broke down into that, the G, what do you call it? G13? Yeah, the 13 moving 13 chords. Yeah. I was totally thinking of that part in Yes's America with the da, 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 on the Tron.
Yeah.
You know?
Right.
And do, 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 do. I was thinking of that. But it was such a wonderful moment for me. I don't know if anybody else thinks it's as crazy cool as I do, but when I went to play the solo on that part and I played it with that crazy Ottawa sound, I just thought, this is the crazy cool thing, man.
Awesome.
I was so into that. Yeah, I still am, but I kept sending notes to Rich like, more in your face.
Yeah, drier.
Drier and in your face.
Yeah, because I think when I sent him the tracks, I'm sort of the clearinghouse of a lot of the tracks. People send them to me, and I sort of sort out. Because a lot of times especially you and I, will play the same parts. Like, I'll do, you know, organ parts through here, and you will too. And so we kind of, okay, check them out, see which one we're going to use. And then I'll ship them all off to Rich. But sometimes I'll do rough mixes here, and I had some effects. I had like an echo on that part you're talking about, and I forgot to turn it off when I exported it. Got printed when I sent it to Rich.
Yeah, that's why I kept saying drier, and it kept not being drier because it was on the track.
Right. He was like, it's off. He had nothing on it.
Yeah. Right. Yeah, it made it sound too pretty, Bill.
Yeah. Don't want that.
No.
And that's something I appreciate about you is the that music should be ugly sometimes too. There should be, you know, it's all about the tension resolve, you know, because to get ugly and then.
Right. Yeah. So. Yeah, sure. Yeah. It's the juxtaposition or the transitions. What's the word I'm looking for? the contrast.
Contrast, yeah.
Yeah, that's what makes it so great. You know, what makes I get up, I get down so great is it's right
all
next
the stuff before.
It's right next to down, 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 right? And just like, ah. Yeah. And then when that resolves, you know, yeah. Yeah, that's the beautiful thing about music, Bill. It's a beautiful thing.
Yep.
Well, that's probably good, man.
Yeah, we've talked a long time.
Yeah. we've talked really long. Yeah, no, it's good, man. It's good talking with you. Always. Well,
thanks for having me on. I hope this wasn't somebody might find this interesting. I hope, but
yeah,
we just talked about whatever came to our minds.
Yes, this is what we do.
That's what it is.
It's almost like how we write music.
And this is and truly, I you know this exact conversation pretty much could have just occurred like this if I had been there when we were just hanging out.
Yeah, totally.
You know, this is what I. This is just a. This is kind of stuff we talk about.
So. Yeah, that's true. That's true. All right, man.
Alrighty. Well, thanks, man.
All right.
Take care.
Take care,
Bill. See you soon.
God bless.
Goodbye.